Welcome back, all of you. See, in the last class, we discussed about the concept of rotating frame, where I mentioned to you, before the application of the radio frequency pulse, the spins were rotating or precessing around the static magnetic field B naught. B naught was static. When you apply a radio frequency pulse, when gamma B naught equal to gamma B1, exactly, which I said is a non-resonance condition, you are bringing the magnetization from Z axis to X axis or Y axis, and they start processing in this plane. You understand? Now I also introduce the condition in the non-resonance thing. What happens? The spins field, B1 field is static and B naught is zero. So it starts processing around B1. And the B naught field is of the order of Tesla, and if you calculate in frequency, it is of the order of several megahertz, hundreds of megahertz. Whereas the RF pulse you apply is much, much smaller in magnitude compared to B naught field, whose frequency, if you calculate, is of the order of 20 to 30 kilohertz. Where is megahertz and where is kilohertz? It is several orders of magnitude smaller. We are applying small power and small magnetic field, and made the spins precess in this B1, along the B1 field, which is assumed to be static in the rotating frame. This is the condition I explained to you. If gamma B0 is not equal to gamma B1, I said we are entering into an off resonance condition where the effective field will be the combination of B0 plus B1. We should be, instead of being here, it will be somewhere here. Then the magnetization, amount of magnetization that is tilted, when it is on resonance, it is a complete magnetization. When it is off resonance, it will be somewhere here. The effective field will be somewhere here. The magnetization which is seen here, if you can resolve into two components, you see the bulk magnetization is not complete. You are not seeing the entire magnetization. The amount of magnetization tilted is much less. So you can manipulate the amount of magnetization that you can tilt in different directions and different axes by applying radio frequency pulses in different directions. We'll discuss about the pulse phases and pulse signal phases later. But this is the basic concept. And I said, this is a pulse is applied in the form of a short RF pulse. In the this I discussed. And you can manipulate the RF power and the pulse to get the desired angle, desired flip angle. Flip angle is the angle at which you are going to flip the magnetization. So, gamma B1 is the power of the pulse. We know gamma, we know pulse width, we know pi by 2. If you want 5 microsecond, you adjust the power accordingly. In other words, I know gamma, I know pi by 2. I can play with RF power and RF pulse to choose the angle of tilting of the magnetization, the amount I want. So, you can manipulate to get the tilt the magnetization to the desired value. Okay. Let us look at this thing, how the magnetization is going to be tilted by any angle, by varying the pulse width and the pulse power. In the first situation, I gave you this equation earlier. Consider 90 degree pulse. I am tilting the magnetization along Z axis and bring it exactly X axis. Okay, the power and the pulse you require. Let us say if I keep the power constant, the pulse width which you require, which is, of course, combination of power and pulse width, to flip the magnetization from Z axis to X axis is called a 90 degree pulse. So it is expressed in few microseconds. The pulse width for a pi by 2 flip angle could be of the order of 5 to 10 microseconds for protons. You can calculate easily. It is easy to calculate. If I double the pulse width, what happens? Keeping all other things constant, I can keep the power constant. This anyway I can't handle. If I double the pulse width, what will happen? This magnetization goes further. It comes to minus Z axis. Interesting, right? I am just increasing the pulse width. I took the magnetization from Z to X, X to minus Z. Now I am going to increase further. Make it 3 times this value, what is used for 90 degree. Then it will come to 270. It from here. He started, this is called a 270 degree pulse. you have tilted the magnetization by 270 degrees, starting with Z, brought to X, minus Z, and took to minus X axis. I'll increase further, make it 4 times the value of this 90 degree pulse width. Then it will bring it back to 360 degrees. It will go here, come back, and complete rotation is done. What did you do? You make the magnetization to rotate one complete precision. It goes one complete rotation from Z to X, okay? X to minus Z to X. So it is rotating in the this thing. So you brought the magnetization by 90 degree from this one, brought here. It took it like this. Keep on making it. You can make it to rotate the way you want. Z to X, X to minus Z to plus Z. You can make the magnetization to rotate in the XZ plane. Remember, from Z came to X, minus Z, minus X, and Z. So you can make the magnetization to rotate in the XZ plane. This, in this way, when you bring the magnetization initially to plus X axis, take it to minus Z, minus X, and Z, you made to rotate 360 degree. Of course, you don't have to stop there. You can continue further. Keep on applying 360, 720 degree further. You can make it go around one rotation, two rotation. You can continuously make the spins to undergo rotation. Understand the beauty of it. You can play with the nuclear spins the way you want. You can make nuclear spins dance according to your tunes. You apply 90 degree pulse like this and bring 180, whatever you want. It will listen to what you want to do. It will bring here if you want, ask you to come here, come here, come here like this. So this way, in this example I have shown, I have made the magnetization to rotate in the XYZ plane. XZ plane. And the direction of tilting, I initially said I will tilt it to X axis. But I cannot apply the magnetic field wherever I want and can tilt it to a particular axis. There is a rule which has to be obeyed, which is followed. The direction of tilting of the magnetization follows the right-hand thumb rule. Please understand this. It follows the right-hand thumb rule. The direction of the thumb is the axis of application of the pulse. Direction of thumb is the axis of application of the pulse. And the curly fingers here tells you which gives you indication in the direction in which the magnetization is going to be tilted. Please understand. Now, let us say this is Z, X, and Y axis. Now, I am going to apply a pulse along this axis. Magnetization is along Z axis. So, what will happen if my thumb is in the X axis? From Z axis, it will tilt to this axis. Curly finger is pointing towards Y. So, if I apply a pulse along this axis, the magnetization which was here will tilt like this to the Y axis. You understand? So, the curly fingers tells you the axis in which the magnetization is going to be tilted, and your thumb tells you that the axis in which you are going to apply the RF pulse. This is the right-hand thumb rule, which you must understand to see where the magnetization is tilting. Okay, let me understand. From this, I'll give you some ideas about pulse phase and signal phase. This we discuss later when you go to some sophisticated discussion. Now, let us take the example of an 90 degree pulse applied on different axes and see what happens to the precision of magnetization in different planes. Apply a 90 degree Y pulse. Of course, this is Y. Y is taken along this axis. This is Y. This is X. See, remember, this is Z. This is Y and this is X. Towards your axis is X. This is a convention followed in this diagram. So, now you are applying the pulse along Y axis. What will happen? Magnetization which is along Z comes to X axis. Remember the previous thing, I said this is X. It was coming under, but only I changed the nomenclature in this diagram, that's all. You are applying the RF along Y axis. The magnetization from Z axis is tilting to X axis. Okay. So this is the curly finger is telling me. My thumb says I am applying the magnetization along Y axis. And it curly finger stays, it is shifting to, tilting towards X axis. Okay. So then continue further. It goes here, go to minus Z, then minus X and Z. So this is the axis it rotates. You can make the magnetization to rotate along the XZ plane. It rotates in the XZ plane. Understand? See here, it comes from here to x, goes to minus z, goes to minus x and z. So imagine now the xz axis is here. It keeps rotating in this xz axis. Okay. What happens if I apply instead of y axis along this axis? If this is my positive x axis, this I consider as negative x axis. What happens if I apply pulse along this axis here? What is going to happen? Now, see, this is the axis you have to do. Think. My thumb is in the negative axis. X was here, minus x is here. So, my thumb is in the minus x axis. Magnetization is z axis. The curly finger is here. That means it comes to y axis. That's what happens. So, now, if I apply the pulse along minus x axis, you are bringing the magnetization to plus y and then apply, keep on increasing the pulse width, make it 180 degree pulse, it comes to minus z, then go to minus y and then goes here. So what is happening here? See, this one, you can make this magnetization to come to y, minus z and this one. It keeps rotating in the yz plane. Very interesting, right? I can make the magnetization to rotate in any plane, in any direction I want. Need not be 90 degrees. I can take along this axis. I can make it to rotate in this plane. In a plane which is where contribution from all other things are there. It can be from, it can, I can make it to rotate here. It is possible. So I can decide the angle, pulse angle and pulse power in such a way I can tilt the magnetization to any axis. I can make it to rotate in any plane. This is the important rule called right hand thumb rule. You must understand. Please don't forget this point. Thumb shows you the direction of application of the pulse. The curly finger shows you which direction the magnetization is going to be tilted. But you understood here. Let us say you have brought the magnetization from z to x axis. It is already here. You are applying the pulse again along y axis here. Further it goes down. So you can keep tracing the path like that. Okay, this you can practice. What happens if I apply the pulse in a different axis like this? You can practice. Okay. Now I'll tell you something about the pulse phase and signal phase. Oh, this is what I was telling you, pulse phase, signal phase. Now phases of the pulse. What is the phase of the pulse? When the pulses can be applied, it is not B, it is B, applied on different axis to tilt the magnetization, accordingly you can define their phases. What does it mean? Go back to here, this drawing. I applied a pulse, 90 degree pulse, to bring the magnetization to x axis. Where did I apply the pulse? Apply 90 pulse y. The application of the pulse here is called a 90 y pulse. When applying the pulse along the particular direction, you can define the direction and the degree. So I call it as a 90 y pulse. If I apply along this axis, I call it as a 90 minus x pulse. If I apply along this axis, I call it 90 minus y pulse. If I bring the magnetization, apply here, such that this magnetization comes from here to here, it is a 180 degree flip. Then it is called 180 y pulse. You understand? I am applying pulse along y axis and tilting the magnetization by 180 degree. Please understand this point. Supposing I apply a pulse along minus x axis and bring the magnetization to this axis. This is minus x, 90 degree x, 90 minus x. I bring it further to minus z axis. This in the same direction you apply. It is 180 minus x. The pulse phases you can mention like this. Remember, a 90 degree pulse brings along y axis, 180 will continue further to minus z, 270 go to minus x. I can make it to rotate along xz plane. Then I can define the pulse on the basis of the axis. 90 pulse along x axis, 90 pulse along y axis, 90 pulse along z axis, minus, see, 270 along x axis. All those things I can decide depending upon the pulse. So a 90 degree pulse, first I apply along minus x axis, bring to y axis. apply 180% along minus x axis, it comes to minus z. It keeps rotating. Apply 270% along minus x, brings the magnetization to minus y. Apply 360 pulse, take it back to z axis. So this way, the pulse phases are the nomenclature is, you have to say what is the type of pulse. It is called a 90x pulse, 90y pulse, 180x pulse, or 180y pulse, like that. These are the nomenclature. If I say in the few, one of the classes, in the coming classes, if I say I am applying a 90x pulse, what does it mean? I am applying pulse along 90 degree pulse along x axis. If this is my x axis and this is y axis, I am bringing the magnetization to y axis. That's all. You have to imagine that way. Of course, this thing you can understand in a better way by using what is called a product operators, which I don't think we are discussing. We will see later. But this is the nomenclature. So magnetization trajectory can be traced depending upon the degree of the pulse and the axis in which you are going to apply it. You can also apply negative axis, I said. You can call it 90 minus x, 90 minus y, 180x, 180 minus x, 180 minus y, etc. Okay? So this is about the phases of the pulses. As I said, you don't need to wait for 90 degree, apply only 90 pulse. You can also apply any angle you like and tilt the magnetization by any degree. For example, I can apply 45 degree y pulse, 45 degree x pulse, 45 minus x, 45 minus y, whatever it is. If I apply 45 degree y pulse, I can bring the magnetization to 45 degree between z and x axis. You understand? You can play with the magnetization the way you want. This is the beauty of NMR. That is why I introduced the concept of bulk magnetization. The magnetization can be made to take, you can take it in any direction in a three-dimensional sphere. If you take that type of the diagram, what I said, showed you in a sphere, is called a grapefruit diagram. In the grapefruit diagram, we saw we can take the magnetization in any plane, make it rotate in any plane. Okay? And you can tilt by any axis by applying pulse in some direction. And this is the beauty. Okay? Now I will tell you something about what is called, what is a signal phase? Signal phase depends upon where we are putting the detector. When I apply a radio frequency pulse, I must detect the signal. Okay, let us say I'm applying radio frequency pulse and RF, and I'm inducing the resonance. Okay, that's what I said, induction of resonance. I said, how do you induce resonance? By applying a radio frequency pulse in a direction perpendicular, I said, we can bring the magnetization to XY plane, tilt it and detect the signal. Now, let us say my detector is here, along the x-axis. I am sitting here to see the signal. Somehow, we have done something and brought the magnetization to mx-axis. What is going to happen now? I am seeing here. But of course, you should understand math in mathematics, which I have not told you. When I do the Fourier transformation, I will tell you more about it later. When the magnetization is along this axis, the time domain signal, I will do the Fourier. Best thing is, let me see. Okay, what I'm going to do is the signal phase I'll introduce to you after the Fourier transformation. Otherwise, you will not know what is real and imaginary. I'll come to that signal phase. You understood the pulse phase. The signal phase will depend on how you detect the signal. I'll come to that later. Right now, please wait for that. Right now, don't get confused. But you understood the pulse phase. Now, magnetization is along z-axis. We are applying RF pulse along x-axis, being like this. Now, we detect this. What we detect is a tipped magnetization. How much magnetization is flipped here? That is what we are going to see. And what happens? It starts decaying like this. Magnetization starts decaying as a function of time. This is a conventional one-dimensional NMR. All you have understood so far, I am applying a 90 degree pulse along some perpendicular axis, and I know which direction I am tilting the magnetization. Let us say I have a detector in the direction, I will start collecting the signal as a function of time. This is called a time domain signal. And it is an oscillatory signal and damped oscillations. it is not oscillation with equal amplitude, you see, not equal amplitude. Amplitude is damping. It is a damped oscillation. This is collected as a function of time. It's called free induction decay, FID. Why it is called FID? You apply RF pulse for a short burst, flash of pulse, like this. And then you don't do anything. Now it is signal magnetization or spins are free from pulses. While because of this pulse, you are tilting. And when you when it goes back, it induces EMF in the receiver. At the same time, the signal is decaying in this plane. So from Z-axis bring to XY plane. In this XY plane, the signal is also called transverse plane. This is a longitudinal plane. Longitudinal axis, transverse plane. In the transverse plane, the signal decays also. So it is free from RF pulses. It induces EMF in the receiver. At the same time, it decays in time. That is why it is called free induction decay. Go to NMR laboratory. You see, all your technicians, what they will do, they will apply a pulse and collect a signal like this. And they will do some mathematical operation to show you the spectrum. This is called free induction decay, FID. Okay. So now I will introduce another word called coherence. What is coherence? This is, we have to understand coherence. To get the signal detection, Fourier transformation, everything I will introduce now. Initially, the magnetization is along Z-axis. Fine. Apply a pulse, bring it to X-axis. This is the magnetization is my concept, bulk concept. But what is happening to individual nuclear magnetic moments? Individual nuclear magnetic moments, they're all aligned at a particular angle and precessing in the cone. Remember that concept. This I brought the concept of magnetization to understand many things. But individual magnetic moments, if you consider, they're all undergoing precession. And their phases, they are not in phase in the X-ray plane because random phase approximation. I said there is no component of the magnetic moment vectors in the X-ray plane. That's what I said. In the transverse plane, mu X or mu Y is not there. They are zero. That's what we said. But now what I'm going to do is, similarly, as soon as you apply an 90 degree pulse, bring the magnetization to this axis, all the nuclear spins, all the magnetic moment vectors, which were rotating like this, temporarily, you bring them into coherence, statistical coherence. This is called phase coherence. At a time, all of them who are rotating like this, simultaneously, you bring them here. They were all, you see, if you look at this one, they were all different spins. Okay, they were all rotating like this. Now all of them you bring it here simultaneously at a time. And we are in phase coherence. This is temporary statistical phase coherence. This is called transverse magnetization. This is a longitudinal magnetization. This is called transverse magnetization. Immediately after the 90 degree pulse, transverse magnetization, the components of all these individual magnetic moments are in phase. All of them are in phase. That's why you see a single bulk magnetization here. You understand? They're all in phase. And this is called coherence. Because there's a phase coherence of all the magnetic moment vectors at a time when they are brought to x-axis. This is called coherence. Please remember, what do you mean by coherence? Apply a 90 degree pulse, bring the magnetization to one of the axes, perpendicular axis. Immediately after that, you see that when the magnetization is brought to x or y axis, all the magnetic moments are in phase. Statistically, all of them are in phase. That is called coherence. Okay. So now if you continue coherence, if the receiver is along x axis, what happens? I have to detect the signal along x axis. Look at it. I am sitting here. This is my receiver. I am looking at it. So I start collecting the signal here. Okay, in this axis. But if I sit somewhere here. If I sit somewhere here. You are not seeing full signal. You are seeing this component. So of course, You don't see the signal here. I'll tell you what happens if the signal is here, receiver is here. That is what is called the signal phase. I'll discuss later. So now what we are going to do is, the receiver is along x-axis to detect the signal. At a given instant of time, what is happening is, all the spin vectors are in same phase. I said this is coherence. Now what is the magnetization? All the spins are added up. Maximum signal is there. All of them are added up. There is a maximum signal, right? So all the spin vectors add up. Vector addition is there along x-axis. And the signal intensity is maximum. Immediately after the pulse, you collect the signal. In the x-axis, you have maximum signal intensity. But what happens to this phase? They will not stay in the same phase for a long time. What they will do is, they will start. Okay, this is what the phase coherence, I said. Now, what will happen to these spins? The spins interact with the surroundings. Okay, this is what I said is the phase coherence. All different vectors, we were in different directions, they all come straight away, all of them at a time along one axis. This is a phase coherence. That is called coherence. Now we will see the spins interact with the surroundings. They are not keeping idle. Okay. When the spins interact with the surrounding, the spins vector start dephasing. They lose their phase coherence. What it means? Those spins which were here, all of a sudden, they lose the coherence. If there is no interference from any external thing, there is no interference at all, it should remain like this forever. But it doesn't happen. What happens is, there are surroundings are there with the nuclear spins. Spins will get disturbed, interacts with the surroundings. The spin vectors start dephasing. All which were in phase, like this, now they will start dephasing like this. Some move faster, some move slower. They all completely start dephasing. They start moving out from this axis. Some move in this direction and some move in this direction. You understand this color is not a good color. See, some spins moves in this direction, some spins moves in this direction. This we call as, with respect to this, this is omega zero, let us say, on resonance. Then all the spins which are moving this side is fast moving component. This is slow moving component. So we can dissolve them into two components. One is fast moving component, other is slow moving component, depending upon the direction. So this, what will happen when the spins start decoherence in the x-ray plane, the signal intensity decays. When everything is added, vector addition, maximum intensity is there. Now they start moving out like this. What happens? Now there is a component, some different axis you have to consider. Resolve them into x and y axis. Take the component addition only, which points in this direction, particular direction. Opposite direction, components get nullified. What will happen? Now the vector addition sum is reduced slowly. So what will happen? The total signal intensity due to addition of all the vector components, which was maximum, starts reducing because of this thing. See now what is happening. Some will start moving like this, some moving like this, fast moving and slow moving components. Now, this vector has a component here and here. So, this has only, this when it was here, it was full amount. Now, the magnetization amount is reduced for this component. Again, for this. So, if you take the vector addition of all these components of resolved into two axes, the magnetization component, let us say, along this axis, now is reduced because the spins are undergoing decoherence. So intensity, which was maximum, immediately after the pulse, starts reducing. Slowly, keep on moving. This is not the end. They keep moving like this. Some more will move, some more will move, some more will move like this. Finally, what happens? After sufficient time, all the spin vectors undergo complete decoherence. When they all undergo complete decoherence, what happens? Remember, we discussed about the random phase approximation. Exactly. Now, if you take vector addition of all these components, there is no signal at all here. It is zero. Totally zero signal. and complete decay will be there. Signal will completely dephase and you don't get any signal in the receiver. Why it happens? This type of interaction happens and makes the spins to dephase because of its interaction with the surroundings. This is a phenomenon called relaxation. That means spins are relaxing. You disturb the spin system by giving energy brought from z-axis to x-axis. Now they are disturbed. You have perturbed them. It wants to relax. So it will go back to z-axis to attain thermal equilibrium. That is one type. But before that, the spins also start undergoing defacing due to surroundings. This is another one type of relaxation called T2 relaxation. That is relaxation in the transverse plane, defacing in the transverse plane. It follows an exponential decaying function. It follows an exponentially decaying function. In the sense, it decays like this. The 100% maximum immediately after the pulse slowly goes. It takes infinite time to reach zero. But doesn't matter. We have, after certain time, we know if it reduces this much, it's enough. We don't have to wait for 5 times the T1. This is a one type of relaxation called T2, also called spin relaxation, also called transverse relaxation. These are the synonyms which I discuss when I discuss more about relaxation measurements in one of the classes later. So what happens? You apply a pulse, start collecting the signal. Signal will not be all the time of the same amplitude. It decays. Amplitude of the signal decays. And that is precisely what I said in the FID here. Remember? This is what the FID. The signal is decaying and it follows an exponential function. That's what I said. Decay is an exponential and is oscillating. During this time, it is inducing EMF. That is the free induction decay. This phase decoherence is due to a term called, phenomenon called relaxation, called T2 relaxation. Okay. So now, spins, what will happen to this? This is defacing in the X-ray plane. But our magnetization initially was along Z-axis. If I have to send another pulse to collect signal once again, the spins should come back to Z-axis. Otherwise, there is no magnetization, no spins. What do I do? The spins have to come back to thermal equilibrium. That will happen. That is another type of relaxation. I'll discuss that in the next class. So you understand, in this class, I introduced you about the phases of the pulses. I have not introduced the phase of the signal, which I'll do later. And then I discuss with you about the coherence and decoherence. And introduce a phenomenon called T2. As a consequence, the signal intensity in the X-ray plane decreases while you are detecting the signal. Immediately after the anti-pulse, you bring the magnetization to the x-axis. Signal is maximum intensity and slowly it decays because it's undergoing decoherence and is an exponential decay. And this decay is what is called a free induction decay, which we call it. So we'll come back and continue with the other type of relaxation and more about signals collection, and we'll start really looking at the NMR spectrum, everything in a subsequent class.